Hello and welcome to this video. Here in the scene, I have a Genesis 8 figure that was exported from DAZ Studio and then imported and rigged here in Blender using the Rig-GNS addon. So this is version 3.74 and this figure was rigged using the rigging buttons here. So in this video, we're going to look at using the Simuquick tab of the addon. Here you can see we have version 1.2. The Simuquick tab helps with the creation of realistic physics interaction for the hair and clothing on the character. Before showing you how this works, let's first import an animation to see how the hair and the clothing deforms without using the Simuquick. So let's expand the Animixer tab, click Import Motion, select Mixamo, and then select any downloaded animation from Mixamo. I'll go with this Roomba dancing animation. And after importing, just click the Bind button and then press Play to preview the animation. We can now see how the hair and the clothes deform, which do not look anything like it's supposed to. So that is why we need the Simuquick tab to make the clothes and the hair deform more realistically. Before we proceed, let's quickly pick the animation for previewing the simulation. Now to do this, I will just click the big button and then click OK. Now we have the animation big down here in the big action panel. Okay, so now let's unlink the animation from the rig, stop the timeline cursor, reset the rig, and collapse the Animixer tab. To start working with the Simuquick tab, we will need to select a mesh. So let's start with this hair. We already have two parts for the hair, the main hair and the tail. And this separation was done in DAZ, and it's a good thing that the tail part of the hair is separated from the main part. If it had come as a single object, we will still need to separate it because it is important to distinguish the part that will be simulated from those that need to remain fixed. Since DAZ has already done the separation, let's go ahead now and select the hair tail and then go to edit mode. The next step now is to create a linear selection of edges or a single continuous path. For instance, I can double click on this edge to loop select connected edges. If double clicking does not loop select the edges for you, try holding down Alt and then click an edge to loop select. This method may vary depending on whether or not you have the emulate 3-button mouse option enabled. Now, the linear selection of edges need to run from the top of the object all the way to the bottom. So let's look for a mesh that spans from the top to the bottom. For a clearer view of the hair, we can isolate it by pressing the division key on the numpad. Now let's find a suitable strand to make the selection. Let's double click on this one and check if it's long enough by pressing Shift Z to go to wireframe mode, and it appears it runs all the way from the top to the bottom. Also, note that it is important to make the selection where the object is closest to the figure, especially for objects with thickness, like this hair. This is just to ensure a sort of interaction or collision between the figure and the object as soon as they make contact. In cases where the meshes and the objects are not long enough to make a linear selection that runs from the top to the bottom, we can create edges for that by extruding a vertex. Let's see how to do that. So first, let's isolate the hair again. Select a single vertex at the top and then press 3 for the side view. Now let's press Shift D to duplicate the vertex and then place it somewhere around the top of the object. Now press E to extrude it. Let's zoom out so the bottom is in view and then move the extruded vertex all the way to the bottom here. Now let's press Ctrl L to select the linked vertex and then Shift H to hide everything else but the selection. And now we have a single edge. Okay, we are going to create several edges from this by right clicking, then select subdivide, and now increase the number of cuts here to 10. Okay, now let's press Alt H to unhide the rest of the hair. But you can see we have our linear selection as well as the rest of the hair all selected. Remember, we only need a single continuous selection for this to work. Now to achieve this, we will just need to expand this option down here, and under Reveal Hidden, just uncheck Select. Now we only have the linear selection spanning from the top to the bottom. Okay, let's switch to solid view and then return to global view. With the linear selection in place, we can click the Create Simu Bone button, which brings up this option. The collision mesh option here is important for objects with a large surface area, especially if you intend to add force field like wind to interact with the object, as this creates a large collision mesh for better physics interaction. However, this option is not necessary for this hair, so let's leave it unchecked. We will explore the effects of enabling this option shortly. Okay, the bone count option allows you to specify the numbers of bones for the simulation. If this option is disabled after clicking the Create Simu Bones button, it means the addon has detected matching vertex groups that will be used to determine the numbers of bones required. While you can leave the option disabled, if you choose to enable it despite the addon's automatic detection, a prompt will appear, and this message will remind you that the object already has matching vertex group for the bone count and will ask you to click OK to proceed with the settings. Alternatively, clicking cancel will allow you to manually specify the bone count. So if we choose to click cancel, now we can enter an integer in this field to set the bone count manually. And for demonstration purpose, let's set it to 7. The last option here is the parent bone, which lets you specify the bone to which the newly created bones will be parented to. The addon currently suggests parenting the bones to the neck upper. However, you can choose a different bone that is more appropriate for the object. And in this case, the head bone will be a better choice as hair is typically attached to the head rather than the neck. So let's change this by clicking on this name field, which then reveals a list of available bones. We can select head and click OK. Alright, now switching to wireframe mode, you can see that we have generated 7 bones for the simulation. When we switch to solid view and press play, the simulation should affect the hair. I'm not satisfied with this result, so let's recreate the simulation bones. And this time, instead of manually specifying the bone count, let's allow the addon to use the matching vertex group found on the mesh to determine the bone count. So now let's stop the animation, return to the first frame, and select the mesh. Click the clear simu bones button to remove the existing and simu bones for the hair. Next, let's create the simu bones again. So go to edit mode and locate the edges we created earlier. Here they are. Double click to loop select and move them out of the hair. Let's now delete these edges as these edges were created later and are not part of the original mesh. So for optimal results, it's crucial to use the edges that are already part of the mesh. Now let's loop select the edges on this mesh, making sure it runs from top to bottom. Switch to wireframe mode and zoom in to confirm the selection. Yes, you can see we have the edges running from top to bottom. Okay, with that done, let's return to solid view. But before creating the simulation bones, let's quickly discuss what those matching vertex groups are. So let's switch to weight paint mode. Select the sample tool here. Now when we click on the hair, immediately it reveals the matching vertex group. You can see we have hip 2, hip 3, hip 4, and hip 5. These vertex groups, also accessible in the vertex group tab here, are detected by the addon and used to determine the numbers of bones. Now switching to edit mode, while still having the linear selection, click the create simu bones button, leave the collision mesh disabled as well as the bone count, then set the parent bone to head and click OK. Once the bones are created, pressing play will show the simulation, making the hair behave as expected. To better preview the simulation, go back to the animixer tab and reassign the picked animation to the rig. Return to the first frame and play the animation. Now you should see the hair moving more convincingly than before, though the current frame length may not be sufficient for the simulation to fully take effect as it ends at frame 70. Later in this guide, I will show you how to extend the length of the animation. So that concludes the setup for the hair. Alright, let's move on to the next item, which will be creating simulation for the sleeves and the cape. First, stop the animation, return to frame 1, unlink the animation, then reset the rig, collapse the animic setup. Next, we are going to select this arm armor object, which comprises of the sleeves and the cape. Remember, we need to separate the parts that will be simulated into independent objects. So switch to edit mode, place the mouse over the sleeve and press L to select the entire vertices since it's a loose part. Then press P, separate by selection. Let's do the same for the cape. With the mouse over it, press L, then P, separate by selection. And again, repeat this process for the other sleeve. Switching back to object mode, we should now have all these separate objects. Let's quickly rename the objects so that we can easily identify them later. Let's select the sleeve, press F2 and rename it to right sleeve. Then select the other sleeve, press F2 and rename it to left sleeve. Finally, we select this cape, F2, and call it cape. All right, let's select one of the sleeves, go to edit mode, and double click to loop select these center edges. It is preferable to be in an orthographic view before creating the simulation bones. So pressing 1 on the numpad gives the orthographic front view, while Ctrl 1 gives the orthographic back view. Creating the simulation in orthographic view helps orient the normal of the simu mesh. Now let's click the create bones button. In the pop-up menu, you can see it automatically enabled the bone count option, and this is because it did not detect any matching vertex group. So let's leave it at 7. The parent bone is set to right shoulder bend, which is what I want. So let's go ahead and click OK. Now that the bones are created for the right sleeve, let's also select the left sleeve, go to edit mode, and double click to select those center edges. Click on create simu bones button. It also has the correct parent bone, which is left shoulder bend, and then click OK. Finally, let's select the cape, go to edit mode, double click to select the center edges, and then click create simu bones. In the parent bone field, let's set this to chest upper rather than the neck lower it was suggesting, and then click OK. Alright, with that done, let's go back to the animator tab, go to baked action panel, select Roomba dancing animation and play it. You can see we are making progress, but there appears to be issues with these sleeves. Now moving frame by frame will help us clearly see the issues. To address this problem, select the objects and enter with paint mode to diagnose the cause of the issue. It appears some of the vertex groups are conflicting with the created bones for this part of the sleeves. The created bones you can see are swinging in one direction, but the sleeves isn't fully following along. And this is because certain vertex groups for the arm bones are also trying to influence this part of the sleeve. To resolve this conflict, go to the vertex groups tab and remove the conflicting vertex group. Be careful not to remove groups with similar names as they are matching groups used by the simu bones. Now let's remove this forearm twist and then this forearm bend, and this should immediately make the tip of the sleeves deform correctly with the simu bones. Now let's switch back to object mode, select the left sleeve and also remove the competing vertex group. And you can see the adjustment also made the left sleeve deform correctly. Again, let's remove the conflicting vertex group for the cape. So switch to its paint mode. In the vertex group tab, remove this right shoulder bend. But keep right collar as it has some influence on the cape. Also remove left shoulder bend, but let's leave left collar and leave chest upper as well. So let's continue removing any other unnecessary vertex group. So now let's switch to object mode and play the animation. Let me hide this overlay for a clearer view. Now you can see the simulation looks much better. So that concludes this lesson. In the next lesson, we'll continue with creating simu bones for this back loin and also look at some of the options and button in the Simuquick tab. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like. If not, I hope you will give me another chance by checking out any of my other videos, especially if you're interested in learning about using DAZ figures in Blender, particularly rigging and animating DAZ figures. So thank you for your time. I'll see you in the next one.